On today's Domain Sherpa Review, our panelists discuss a domain name lease. They discuss the staggering number of domain transactions that occur under NDA. They also discuss how an outbound broker does vision casting as part of their sales process. Enjoy the show. Hey, Sherpa Network. Thanks for joining us today. I'm Tess Diaz, executive producer of DomainSherpa.com, and this is the Domain Sherpa Review. This is a show where we get into the minds of successful domain name investors using real examples so we can learn strategies and tactics to become better investors ourselves. We have three segments to the review. We'll start off learning what the Sherpas recently bought or sold. Next, we'll discuss in value an investor-submitted domain name portfolio. And finally, we'll preview some names going to auction soon at namejet.com and whether the Sherpas think they're a good investment opportunity for you. Joining us today on the Domain Sherpa Review are three industry thought leaders. We are delighted to have back, as usual, Shane Coulter of DSAD. Hello, Shane.
How are you doing today?
Great. Glad to have you. And Braden Pollack of Legal Brand Marketing. Hello, Braden.
Hey, kids.
And super excited, first-time panelist, long-time industry Sherpa, Kate Buckley of Buckley Media. Hello, Kate.
Hey, Tess. Happy to be here.
So glad. You know, it took a couple months of scheduling to get you on, but total coincidence that you just closed a very sweet deal this week.
I love it.
Hold on. Hold it up. Razor, this is cute.
I didn't know it was coming.
You got to be ready, Braden.
Now we know why Kate's been so busy.
Yeah, now we know why. Yes. So, Kate, big congratulations on selling chocolate.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Yeah. I know it's not your biggest deal, I'm sure, but it is the closest to my heart, that's for sure. I don't know what else you've heard, but that's my favorite. That's right. And all our poor podcast listeners, you're going to miss Braden holding up the bar, the giant bar of chocolate that he literally just happened to have ready for this show. So, sweet.
Too bad I can't share it with you guys, because I'm going to crack it open in a minute.
It's organic, though. That can't be good.
Chocolate is chocolate, buddy.
Yeah, try that when you get 90% cacao or whatever you pronounce it. It is not chocolate anymore at 90%. Trust me.
It's. I'll have you know it's 73.
That's good. That's actually my favorite. It's my favorite temperature and my favorite cacao concentration.
And Shane's age.
And yeah, your age.
Boom!
Just my heart.
You started it, buddy.
Oh, wow.
It's going to be a long show right here.
Oh, dear.
Right. Only 3.5 hours to go.
That's right.
We had like the longest warm-up ever because we were having so much fun. Kate, I do want to mention, especially for our, again, poor podcast listeners, you miss out. I love total coincidence behind you. You've got a little saying, she's whiskey in a teacup. And you are a smart businesswoman, and I'm delighted to have you here. So let's jump in. What's new, Sherpas? So we're going to share one purchase or sale you've made over the past few weeks. And typically, we find out what you paid or received for the domain. And then we really like to hear a little inside scoop on the negotiations. So now, of course, we might have some areas where we can't talk about stuff, and that's okay. We will just work it through and find some fabulous things to talk about. So that said, Shane, you are up first. What's new?
All right. So I got a bunch of boring sales. So I will say I bought a name that I thought was interesting. We'll see if they even agree, if they think I paid $3 for it. But I bought Organibus. O-R-G-A-N-I-B-U, like cannabis and organibus.
Okay, organibus.
Yeah.
What do you guys think? So he bought it, he didn't sell it.
I bought it.
and in the beginning, he doesn't tell us, you know, if it was an expired domain, if it was a buy it now or what. What do you think, Braden, what do you think Shane would have paid for Organibus?
Oh, God, I hope very little. I don't want to, hate's a strong word, and I don't want to.
I'm a big boy. I can take it.
Because $57 you paid for it.
$57. I don't even know how to spell it, I have to tell you. O-R-G-A-N.
Yeah.
And then what?
B-I- Organibus. Let me just.
He doesn't know how to spell it either.
Don't even
I can't spell cannabis. Maybe, I can't spell cannabis straight up either.
Hate is not such a strong word after all. What's the minimum on NameJet now?
Yeah, it's just like O-R-G-A-N-A-B-I-S. Organibus.
I bus. Organ.
Organic. Or organ A-B-I-S. How about that?
A-B-I-S. You don't even know, you're guessing?
No, I had to type it out. I type it, I mean.
This not only fails the radio test, it fails every possible test. What other tests are there?
It's gonna How else would you spell it?
I don't.
Whoa, how much time do we have?
Yeah.
Like, I don't know how to spell it, and neither will the
I'm just going to go ahead and say I overpaid for it, then. Keep going.
Okay, I'm literally going to the Whois to check that you can spell your own name right.
No, I know it's right. I checked it.
All right, Terrence.
Now, don't give away all my secrets. People are going to start tracking me.
Okay. All right. Well, the Whois says.
I have enough stalkers and haters. You don't have to give out my real name.
Oh, well, I'm sure that's going to dramatically change now that you've announced your brilliant acquisition of Organibus.
Wait till I sell it. I can't wait to come back to this one. This is going to be legendary. Let's keep
going. Can we take
his it's legendary.
Can we take away his Sherpa card now?
You just wait.
Shane's screen just goes black.
Exactly.
Okay. Or purple. Braden thinks that Shane acquired this for $57. What do you think on today's market would be a fair market price that Shane would pay for Organibus?
I hope he did not pay a lot. Maybe he paid $150.
Okay. All right.
I think that if he paid $57, he got robbed, and the person that sold to him scored. That's what I think.
This domain was created, I'm looking at the Whois, created in 2014.
Wow.
So it has been renewed 5 times. Shane, where did you buy this domain?
So I bought it at expired auctions.
Okay. Someone let that go. Can you imagine?
$498.
Wow.
And I will find my email on my $2,000 offer several days later. Because I got into a bidding war with somebody, like 2 or 3 people. Yeah, I mean, I can go through the scroll. But, yeah, it wasn't only me sitting there. Otherwise, I'd have bought it for $57.
Yeah.
I do like it. And there is, if you look up the trademarks and the brands, there's people, the organic cannabis, there's people going organic canna. There's people going the organic cannabis route.
So that's true. And it's much better than organic chocolate.
It tastes much better. Yeah.
I guess you are the plant guy, so we will defer to you.
Well, it's you know, there's all kinds of plays, but I will say that most of my plant-oriented brands have been just fine. You know, this one may be a stretch because I do agree with you on the spelling, but I always, when I'm typing out cannabis, even that, I'm thinking, is there an I? You know, I have to type it out to spell it out when it comes to canna. So I just say canna all the time.
Yeah.
On canna. But no, there's definitely a stress. That's why I said it. If I didn't want to be ridiculed, I never would have brought that.
And Shane,
70X.
This is like why we have you on the show all the time. Yeah. Because you're willing to really share your thought process. So how many bidders were there?
There was plenty. Like I said, I think what's even worse about this is I got into a bidding war towards the end of it. So not only that, not only was there one dumb person, there were 2 of us going head to head. It was a brilliant thing.
You know, yeah, I have a neighbor in Des Plaines, Illinois.
It's Des Plaines, but.
Oh, yeah. Because he just registered organibus.com just a couple months ago.
That's an organic bus, though. That's a totally different thing.
Oh, yeah. Those are in high demand.
Yeah.
Shane, I will tell you something I do like about it is safety in the cannabis space is everything, right?
Yeah.
And you know, and then like right now we're learning like the glyphosate and Monsanto with the wheat, blah, blah, blah. And so yeah. Cannabis users, smokers, what have you, right? That's a concern. What are they, what are they treating the cannabis with? You know, there's Cannabis Safe, there's independent testing companies. So if the acquiring company for, Organibus does a good job visually branding it, right, and getting the brand story right, particularly if they're B2B, I think it could be good for the right user.
Yeah, I mean, it's organic cannabis is what I was looking for, and it just a name that came up that was in that area. And it's, I don't think a brand's going to be organic cannabis. I don't think that's what an organic cannabis company is going to call themselves.
Right, right.
So that's what we talk about all the time on this show is, generally, people aren't going to name themselves after the product. That's not always the case, but there's only one mattress.com. Everybody else is going to have a catchy name that sells mattresses. So people that register all these names with it in the name, these companies are either going to pivot or expand, and they don't want to be pigeonholed through their name. So that's why they're getting a brand that's a first name or a fish or something along those lines. So that's what I shoot for. That's what I'm looking for. So they may not make sense to anybody here, but it only has to make sense to one person.
Good point.
And you know, Shane, like this was too good not to have a good laugh over, but I clearly see why you would pay $500 for that.
I've paid $500 for a lot worse things, I guarantee.
Yeah. Here's my question.
But we can't talk about those things.
No, they're under NDA.
Here's my question, Shane. To the average user sitting at home who is trying to learn about domain investment, what percentage of your portfolio is really something that we would all ridicule you for? Something that's kind of far out.
This is all my investments. 2%. 2% of my stocks are high-risk options or purchases. My domains are probably going nowhere, but I'm having fun or trying things or being funny. I have, if you look at my portfolio, I have hamsterinsurance.com. And it's one of my most fun names. When I email somebody and I tell them I'm in the hamster insurance business, I laugh every time. Nobody really does. I think it's hilarious. But when I say I'm Shane at hamsterinsurance.com and they're like, I go, yeah, that's what I do for a living. You would be surprised. These things, they die so fucking quick that you have to buy insurance. And that's what I do.
The premiums are cheap though, right?
Yeah.
The deductible's like.
Yeah, so you have to buy hamster insurance. It's just
part of. Does hamster insurance include the cost for like an option for replacing the hamster with a similar looking hamster?
So here was my original plan, is to send them a shoebox with a t-shirt in it. So they can wear the shirt that said they purchased the hamster and then the shoebox to bury it in. And that was my hamster insurance ploy.
Does hamster insurance cover loss of use?
It could. I haven't written the policy completely.
Wait, so is there a clause in there if the hamster doesn't smoke and runs on the wheel an hour a day?
There is a pre-check. I got to see a wheel video.
Okay. Yeah. They get a discount.
Yeah. So
wow.
We all have. I mean, maybe
wait,
not
wait,
everybody,
I have another
but
hamster
I have a
insurance
time.
Question. So does the hamster have to pee in a little cup?
Oh, that's the hardest part of this whole process. That's checking, drawing blood, and then the peas. Oh, screw it.
That's rough. You should buy hamster insurance healthcarecheck.org.
Yeah.
Okay, so 2% of your portfolio is high risk, wild high and wacky, risk. Whatever.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's super smart. That's good business. And
I still have to have some fun with this stuff. I mean, we know this so well, to not have a couple fun emails. And again, I don't want to get on a rant, but I bought champagneillinois.org, and I have sent so many notations to my friends for defecating in the park or peeing. It's just brilliant. When you go and run with a new person and they have to go off and pee, I immediately send them from champagneillinois.org and emails with a fine letter for peeing in the park. And it works the first time every single time.
You have too much time on your hands.
That's what life's all about, of these kind of things. I mean, I think everything's funny. My friends think I'm totally crazy. But that's what domains can do for you.
All three of them?
Yeah, it's a good laugh. You can set up a website overnight. It's just, you got to have, that's 2%. The other ones pay the bills. These are the fun.
That's, you know, you're a fun guy, Shane. And I think that domains, people who get into domains, they think differently. And I think that tide is turning. And soon we're going to have more and more mainstream people who see domains as just another asset class for investment. But until then, we've got hamster insurance and Organibus.
That's right. That's
I like it.
Organibus. There's going to be a $300 profit in that someday.
Woo! All right, Braden.
What?
Tell me a domain that is better than hamster insurance or Organibus that you have recently bought or sold.
Not a fair fight.
Okay, so let's see. Got to be something interesting. I sold a name a couple of months ago that has been announced. But I don't suppose you guys would remember it. It was announced.
Is it a oneletter.org?
No, it's not. No, it's a oneword.com. So we can talk about that one. Or I just yesterday leased a name, a smaller name, that hasn't been announced anywhere because it's just a lease. So
can you talk about that name?
Or we can do both.
Ooh la la. I wish this were our Facebook Live and our Sherpa Network could vote. I want to hear about the lease and how the lease got structured.
I vote for lease.
Kate?
Sounds good.
Okay.
You don't care. She doesn't care.
I don't.
She just knows you're going to be fascinating.
Actually, I really wanted to hear about both, if I'm being honest.
Okay.
Okay, I can do them both quickly. So I sold surround.com. It was announced. So if you don't remember it, then take a guess what I sold it for.
How long ago?
And what I paid for it this year.
January. So you want them to guess what you paid to acquire it and what you sold it for.
Yeah, or it's your show. You whatever you want.
Ooh. You guess what you want to guess. How's that?
That's nice.
That's nice.
So Kate can go first, though. Let her go first.
surround.com. I like that. I really like that.
Thank you.
You may have bought it a while ago for $25,000, and you may have just sold it for.
You can ask when I bought it.
No, I don't want to know. Okay. I actually don't want to know. Right. And then you may have sold it recently for
$325,000. Okay. All right. It's a good guess. I would like to say I'm cheating and Googling because I'm the moderator. And I Googled, well, I don't usually guess, but I just Googled surround.com Braden. And I would like you to know that there is a Braden iron bed with Surround that, first of all, does very well in the search engines. But just might be a new nickname you want to work on with Lisa. Maybe the bed's named after you. I don't know. Anyway, Shane, go ahead and guess.
I can tell you.
I was going to say that's his nickname. So that's probably him. Well, it does depend when you bought it. There's a huge, the difference between last year and this year on purchasing a name and selling it is a whole nother. I'll go higher on the buy. I will say on Surround, you paid $60,000, and I will say you sold it for, I don't know. I'm not on here enough with you to know where your wheelhouse is on how you feel in certain times. Like, I've got Drew down to an art, depending on what month he's in and where he's at on. But I will say, God, that's a huge name. I'll say 250, just because I know that you don't get out of bed for less than that.
Out of an iron bed?
Iron bed.
So I had it, I bought it in beginning of March of 2017. So I had it less than 2 years.
Not very long.
I paid $15,000 for it.
Yeah.
And I sold it for $150.
Yeah. Well, if you get it for 15, then 150 correlates much
better. It's fine. Yeah. So, you know, I don't think it was a 250 or 350 name because it's kind of an oddball name, right? So you can't just name a product because it's not a thing, right? So you can't name a product. So, I mean, I actually don't know what they're doing with it.
Well, unless it was like a augmented reality, like that's surround, like that AI fits as well to that.
No. Shane, that's exactly
where did it go?
That's exactly what I thought when I heard surround.com, and that's why I went a little higher. That's of course what I would have sold it for you.
Well, because you, well, you know, you're prettier than I am.
Here we go again.
And we're gonna close it.
You're right.
Oh,
exactly.
For all those that don't know, this is an inside joke about people always accuse her of being pretty. That's why she can sell names, which is of course is totally ridiculous.
Yeah.
All right. So the other name,
Wait, you don't get to go to the next name yet. So surround.com is being used. It says we are building a better music economy, open and shared, by championing the artists and their intellectual property. I love Surround and how positive it is. Upbuilding, empowering, but you're right, it's difficult to be a product or service.
Surround sound was something I had thought of.
Okay. What really catches my ear is that you sold it without knowing who they were or what they intended to do with that. Is that typical for you?
Yeah. I mean, it's not, sometimes I know, sometimes I don't. If I can identify who the buyer is and what they do, then I can figure it out. But you know, under this was a startup, so I didn't know what the guy was doing, so I couldn't figure it out. I knew what I wanted for the name.
Yeah.
And look, at the end of the day, my price is my price, and whatever you want to do with it, I don't care. Like most people, you know, they've got their startup, or they've got a blog, or they've got whatever it is, and you know, they can't afford it. They want a $350,000 name, or they want $1 million name. But they're like, but this is perfect for my whatever. What? That's not relevant to me.
Yeah, it doesn't matter.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, good to know. And, you know, I think a lot of companies, more often corporations than startups, have a real fear of revealing themselves in the purchase process, that they think that will affect the price. And there may be times when that does, particularly like if they've already gotten trademarks in 24 countries and haven't thought of buying the domain yet, and you know they're heavily invested into it, but most of the time the price is just the price.
I mean, this is what upsets me is people they talk about the school kids pretending to be school kids or pretending to be this or that. You're the seller. Don't worry about who the other side is. You have a price, and if you're happy with what you get, don't kick yourself later if Microsoft bought it. That's your own fault, because if you change prices based on the guy, there's a reason they became the school kid, because they think you're more likely to change your price based on who you sell it to. Just get rid of that. Who care? I don't care. I'll insert whatever that name is at the top. I don't really care. I have a price, and if I am happy with it, then I'm happy with it. It's irregardless of what they're going to use it for, unless it's a company that says I'm a startup and I can't afford to pay for the name, then we can get into a little bit more detail about who you are, and maybe I can be part of your company percentage. You know, then we're in a different realm. Once we start
a payment plan.
Yeah. And I think too, as more people on both sides of the table understand from places like Domain Sherpa that there are, you know, comparable sales, that there's a market, there are daily fluctuations, whether it's in acronyms, brandables, one word.coms, that there are actual market trends. And when we see like reports from escrow.com and other parties, that really helps, I think, the industry as a whole and creates a trust between buyers and sellers to know where these prices are coming from.
Yeah. Now, I have a question just to not get off. But do you too, when you go in to buy a name, I just use my name, and Drew and I have talked about it. Drew's gotten to the point where it's helpful. At first, when he went in there, they would raise the price because he's Drew and they think he's going to pay a lot. But then it's actually changed because they knew Drew will buy the name, that he's there to buy, and that they're going to give him a price that's a sellable price because they know that he's not going to be there and waste his time, which I thought was, you know, that's why I changed. I just said, hey, I'm Domain Shane, or I'm Shane Coulter, and I'm coming to buy the name. I'm not Johnny Montgomery, and I'm in eighth grade, and I want to do a site. I just say my name. Do you both go in with your own name, or do you use alternate names, or can you even ask the question?
I'm happy to answer it. I use my full name on everything, on all forums, on bidding, on emails. I fully believe in transparency in every aspect of this industry. And I think it's ridiculous to hide behind an alias. And, you know, I also believe that the value is the value is the value. And like Drew, I have found that if I'm transparent about who I am, people are like, oh, well, she gets it. So let's just have a fair and reasonable conversation and make something happen versus hiding behind crazy identities.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I'm not using my real name right now. and this is an avatar. So that's how I feel. No, I just use my real name. You're bidding on NameJet, whatever. It's just my name or legal brand. So everybody knows it's me. I don't hide who I am. I mean, sometimes I might get bid up because they think that I can afford it, but I'm going to pay what I'm going to pay. So it doesn't matter. When I'm reaching out, maybe it's an end user, definitely use my real name because who the hell am I? They can Google me, and then they can see that I'm like a legitimate person that's really in this space. So I think it's helpful in that case.
Yeah, I agree, especially if you're working with people who bought domains in the 90s, and there was a lot of confusion, lack of transparency, ability to lose domains, especially unfairly. If you're selling intangible assets, and I think, you know, particularly Braden and Kate were looking frequently at 5, 6, and 7-figure transactions. Something needs to be transparent. You can't even touch what you're selling. It's not like somebody's showing up with suitcases of cash at your front door.
Well,
so no, the only thing.
You really have to for Organibus. We don't allow credit cards.
I'm getting on a plane right out of this. Make you an offer.
I'll tell you that I did sell a name for cash once.
Yeah. Really?
Yeah.
Do you tell.
Where?
Where?
Yeah. Where was the drop site?
In my house.
Is that the cash behind
it's
you?
It's on the back. It was $67.
And there it is. I told them I would only do the deal if the money was framed.
Yeah.
For real or no?
No, that's not the sale. No, the sale was, and it was a significant sale.
Wow. Okay, well, you were going to talk about a lease, but Braden, now I just want to know everything.
Everything?
Everything.
How long is this show? 4.5 hours? Is that... so the lease. Yesterday, I leased monopolize.com.
Oh, monopolize.com.
Yeah.
There's monopolize. A go-getter. Okay, you leased it.
It's an odd name, right? I mean, monopolize is kind of, I think it has a little bit of a negative, but I have sold names that have negative connotations. So I don't shy away from buying them. So I bought that, I think 5 months ago.
Okay.
And
so we're going to guess the total lease amount, like when it's all said and done, how much you'll have received.
It's a lease. It's not a finance.
Ooh.
So
Is it a one-year lease?
So they're renting it monthly.
Okay.
For as long as they want.
So is there a down payment plus monthly?
Nope. Just
straight
a monthly. Because there's no assumption of equity.
Okay.
So if they ever want to buy it, fair market value at the time. Whatever my price is, my price will be.
Very cool. All right, guys. What do you think he leased it for per month?
I'll go first this time. I'll say $1,500 a month, just because he knows it's not long term and he still can sell the name later, so he'll take the cash. That'd be a nice $18,000, or what is it? What did I say? $1,500? Yeah, $18,000.
Spelling and math.
No, I got the math part down. As long as it's three digits and three digits or less.
Got it. Okay.
I can't even follow that.
Math hack.
Yeah.
That's a tough one. I'm gonna say $2,100 a month.
Okay. So pretty close guesses to each other. Seems like a typical amount for a monthly lease. Monopolize.com. Would you lease it for, Braden?
Do they want to guess what I paid, or should I say what I leased it for, and then we guess what I paid?
Oh, that's a good point.
Maybe leased it for first.
Hey, Google. I'm just kidding.
Do you know how many people's Googles are now, like their Google Home?
Yeah, we had to change mine to it's only my wife's voice. So, because every time I say anything close to it, it would light up and ponder.
Okay, am I saying
lay it on us. What are you getting each month?
$325 a month.
Well, okay, so now I'll guess how much you paid for it.
Okay, so I mean, there probably aren't a ton of users out there, and you're drawing some ROI one way or another. Good for you. How long ago did you buy it? You said 8 months?
I bought it like 5 months ago. Let me look it up. I'll give you it.
Okay. So my guess is that's going to pay for the domain at the end of the year. That's how I think you got a good price on it.
I bought it October 7th.
Okay. I mean, that's pretty quick to be making money back on it, honestly. And you bought it as an expired domain or otherwise?
I bought it on NameJet, so I don't know.
Okay, so possibly expired, possibly there. They're about 50-50 these days. Yep. All right, Kate, what do you think he paid for Monopolize?
Did Shane guess?
Yeah, I say you paid $3,000. But
okay, $3,000-$4,000. What'd you pay, bud?
Wait, Kate, what'd you say?
I said $4,000.
$3,000 and $4,000. Got it.
I say $1,634.
I say cheater.
Yeah. Yeah, I think it was 1674. You look too fast. 1674.
Shane, we're so disappointed in you.
No.
Okay, 16, so
1634.
So Shane, do that fancy math.
Is it 1634?
Like 5 or 6 months and you'll have made back your money.
Mm-hmm. On the 6th month you will start counting profits. Mm-hmm.
And with no risk, really. I mean, how on earth did you find a buyer and negotiate this in the first place? They just came to you?
First of all, I never find buyers. They come to me. I don't, that sounded kind of arrogant. No, I don't do outbound. So it's just inbound only. Because I'm lazy. And so somebody,
you're efficient with you. I really don't like this whole domain speculator, you know, name calling. Braden, you have very diverse assets and you are efficient with them. So
I like that, Tess. Well said.
Thank you.
You may continue speaking now, Braden.
Sorry, Mom. Inbound, so the guy asked me how much it was. I quoted $25,000. And he said, I just want to lease it.
I'm just using it for spam email. I don't want to own it.
He actually did want to own it. So he wanted, he actually asked for a financing plan. And so of course I wanted a down payment and I wanted larger payments, you know, you know, I would go a year or two. So he wanted smaller payments. And I said, well, if you just want to lease it, just want to rent, that's fine. So he opted for that to get a smaller payment, which is fine because, you know, I still own it. I can still sell it later.
And you have enough money to buy a Kia Optima on a monthly plan.
Oh, I thought you were going to count that. How many Monopoly board games he could buy.
Yeah. I really like the Kia Optima angle better, but anyway.
You know, it's your humor versus but it proves that these kind of negative connotation names, they still work. You know, people.
My favorite name in my portfolio is uncomfortable.com. Everybody told me it was a negative name, and I think it's fantastic. I love it.
That was a great sales term not long ago, right?
Yeah, it's been a couple of years. I paid a lot of money for it, but it's.
I bid on that name.
Yeah. Well, no, you didn't bid on it because I bought it privately out of the name find portfolio from GoDaddy.
Oh, that's probably where I know I saw it. I think I made an offer on it, and they.
Yeah, it's been my mantra, but I think I got it cheaper because they viewed it as a negative name. They wouldn't sell it, but yeah, mm-hmm. Negative names can be made positive, if you brand them correctly. But that's true of anything, isn't it? Yeah.
And they probably take longer to sell. And if you know, either if that's your strategy with your whole portfolio, or you have a section of your portfolio, that's fine. But
I think the difference between a good salesperson. So when you have to explain why it's a good name, that's trouble. But if you can, and Kate and I have talked about this before, if you can put in their mind what it can be used for and the story that it can be used to tell, then you can kind of guide them in a direction that they wouldn't have gone otherwise. You're not gonna tell them, well, this and this, and that doesn't work. But if you can talk about uncomfortable and that people, when they get better, they have to get into an uncomfortable range to be strong, then they start thinking about these kind of things, and then you can change a mind. But it has to be brought or sold in a certain way to be able to do that. But that's the art of sales.
I was trying to think, I found this other negative name that I sold. It was a couple of years ago. I sold it in January of 2017. I sold breakable.com, which, you know, that's kind of a negative, right?
Yeah.
And I had it for 7 months. I paid $1,500. I sold it for just over $6,000.
Yeah. That's still a good return.
Yeah.
It is.
I mean, it's quick, you know, 4X, but it's also kind of an odd name. But I think almost any English language word that people know has value, some value, as long as you buy it right.
Yeah.
Well, that's absolutely right. Yeah.
It was Richard Dinas sold, what did he sell? Hate? What was the negative?
Hatred. It was hatred.com. Hatred. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And then we just had chaos.com announced.
Yeah, but that's not, I don't think that's so negative. I mean,
it's not as negative as hatred, but it's still. I mean, yeah. I don't know about you. I don't like to live in chaos.
Yeah, but think if you're like, you know, like a clothing brand, anything party related.
It's great for Surf and Skate. And I believe a software company bought it, right? I can definitely make a branding argument for that all day long.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. So even chaos software, like why?
Exactly. Yeah.
Because it's memorable.
Mm-hmm. So Shane and Braden, you rely with your portfolios on if you receive an inbound inquiry or you list them with buy it now prices. Now, Kate, you do outbound brokerage on behalf of clients. And I heard you just now say, you know, if you can, actually, I forget what word you use now, but if you can, you know, create a brand vision, basically, or present a brand story. How often in outbound selling a premium 6 to 8 figure domain do you feel that you need to present that with a brand vision at the same time?
Look at Braden. That's a great question, Tess. It so depends on the name. You know, for some companies, the name just makes so much sense that there's not a lot of storytelling or vision to be shared. With others, I have to talk them into it. And I have to come up with a very compelling reason to get them to buy in to that vision. Because, you know, of course, some of it's numbers, right? Here's how it performs in search, and here's the CPC, and here's what you'll save, right? And like your CMO is going to look like a rock star. Your board's going to be super happy, yada, yada, yada. But I also find they need to buy into the long-range vision as well, right? It has to be sort of there has to be something that appeals to the ego about it, right? It's aspirational for their brand, right? And then inherently for themselves as a founder or a CEO.
About a category killer name?
Yeah, well, that's a different conversation. But I will say, for like sort of category killer, the sleeping and snoring sale I did. In the beginning, the buyer was like, I don't need it. I just don't need it. And I'm like, well, I think you do. And here's why. And my argument was very simple. I mean, it's so, so simple. It was this. It was, okay, I'm dating someone who is a terrible snorer. Happily, I am not. But in my story, right? So say I'm dating someone who's a terrible snorer. And I'm just like, oh my God, I have to break up with this guy. I can't get a good night's sleep. But I love him. I want to do something to fix it. So I start searching for solutions, right? And I'm not going to search for CPAP machine. I probably never heard of one. But I am going to search for snoring, right? And so I started sharing that story with him, along with the other stories around search and CPC. And how he would lower his cost of customer acquisition while increasing his bottom line company valuation. But I kept telling the story, positioning myself as his consumer, right? And because that's how I sell domains. I'm like, well, I'm a consumer. How do I see this domain? How would I use this domain? And then I switch, right? Okay, I'm a founder. How would I use this domain, right? You have to wear both hats and sit in both seats to really be able to share that vision effectively with buyers.
That's really fascinating, especially to see. I mean, it was over $1 million your sale last summer, right? Sleeping.com and snoring.com. Mm-hmm. And I mean, to put $1 million down on something that a short time earlier they passed on and didn't see the value, that's quite the media education that you gave for free, you know?
Well, it wasn't free.
No, it wasn't. It wasn't free.
Not in the end, because he got it. He passed the class.
But it was a story that he took home and probably told his wife or her. I don't know if it's a male. And they gave an opinion on it. So you've set a little hook in there that now they can discuss and a couple of friends. Oh, you could own sleeping and snoring. You know, that's how it works. Mm-hmm. And then they get excited at night, and the next thing you know, they want to talk more about it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And you know, when I first started working at GoDaddy in 2012, as an executive account manager, doing, you know, sales and consultation, I actually often explained to people Rick Schwartz's story at the time, probably in about, you know, 2011, was about candy.com and how he was like, Hershey's doesn't get it. They don't understand. They're so focused on building their brand and their brand recognition that they're not looking at the folks who don't have a brand loyalty developed and capturing them. And so those are two different facets of brand development and who you're trying to target in the process. But ironically, now I told that story for like 2 years, like 10
but times but don't but don't you think that there is a point in a business they don't need that? Like Hershey's is such a huge brand that gaining candy is more a protection purchase, whereas some new person can come in and join with candy. So it's actually more valuable to a third party than it ever would be the big boys. And people mistake that often. They go, oh, they're the biggest. They must want it. But sometimes they're fine. They don't, you know.
Unless you're looking at the opportunity cost of letting someone else come in to their
market. And that's the protection word that I use.
To look at it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Right. And there are big companies that do get it. So like Johnson & Johnson has giant category killer names, and Salesforce has spent millions and millions of dollars buying, you know, data.com and allwork.com and a lot of fantastic names. Spreadsheet, I think, tons of great names. So some companies get it and some don't. I own pineapple.com, and Dole made an offer of $38,000, which of course is preposterous. They don't get it. And, you know, should they have the name? Probably, right?
Yeah.
So somebody else doesn't get it. But the chances are that name won't, like candy, it won't go to a company that's selling pineapple, right? It'll be a brand.
Right. Yeah.
Pineapple Resorts or something.
Love it as a brand. Yeah.
I do too. But to Shane's, Tess.
That's okay. Go ahead.
But to Shane's point, it's like the old advertising 101 case study of Ace, Avis versus Hertz, right? Avis led with, we're number two. And the tagline is, we try harder, right?
Right.
So getting these companies who are maybe number eight in the top 10, right? And they really want to break the top three or top five. Then I share the story of how this domain can help them get there.
Yeah.
So that's that goes back to the aspirational piece. Sorry?
Yeah, that to me, that's an easier sell than someone that's already at the top and trying to convince them. I mean, my only arguments have ever been, you have no problem spending $168,000 for a 30-second ad that wasn't very good with nothing. So this domain, this is half of an advertising, and yeah, that doesn't even count production. So there are things that they're spending on marketing that are nowhere close as valuable as what they're, that's the only direction. You can't say you're going to get better with this name. Mm-hmm. They're maybe not going to get better. They're just not going to allow anybody else to get better. They're kind of,
I like to say that they come at it from this marketing perspective. These are marketing dollars, which is usually where they get the budget from.
Yeah.
And I say, but the thing is that these aren't sunk costs, because this is an asset that you'll still have. And if at any point you want to sell it, you can. And it'll be worth at least as much, if not more.
Right.
And you got to use it the whole time.
Right. Yeah. Right. I just sold a name. It was a company that shortened their name. And it was a five-figure name, low five-figure name. But they didn't feel they needed to. It was like a second generation, company that had this name for a long, long time. And they didn't see the need to shorten their name. And I explained that emails are not getting, and the people that are going to a website that's not there because of the confusion. And I explained the value, and ultimately they pulled the trigger. And then, and the value was like, look, if you want to get rid of it later in 2 years, you're like, it doesn't mean anything to us. Just sell it. So that's what convinced them. And then once they bought it, they got feedback from customers and from staff, and then they were thrilled that they spent the money.
That's neat. Really neat. Yeah. So I told this story for years, but I had it wrong. I always said chocolate.com instead of candy.com. So funny, which brings us to today. And Brayden, seriously, you're killing me.
Every time we say chocolate, I'm going to take a bite.
Oh my, I want Amazon Prime ringing my bell. Like, by the time we're done filming. So Kate, tell us about a domain you've recently bought or sold.
Well, first I want to say that I did not buy that sign for myself, because that would be weird. That was a gift from my amazing grandmother, who is super fun and awesome. And that's, it's an old Southern saying, I'm a ninth generation Kentuckian, and she's whiskey in a teacup. So that was one of her fun gifts to me this past Christmas. And so thanks, Berta. Hey, Berta.
Really sweet. You are a ninth generation Kentuckian.
I am.
Wow. Kate, yeah. I mean, that's true grit. You're a powerhouse. Okay.
Is it grit because now she's in Laguna?
Did I tell you about my cousin that lives in Laguna Beach?
Hey, I live in South Central Laguna. I want to clarify. I want to be really clear about that.
Southern Laguna Beach.
Okay.
All right. Wow. Moving on. Anyway, yeah. So Brayden, get ready to take another bite. Unfortunately, as I was sharing with you guys earlier, quite a few of the names that I've sold recently, I have not been able to share and can't really share details about because they're under NDA, as we all know, many large sales are quite frequently. But
why is that, Kate?
I'm so glad you asked. it may be that a company is buying the domain for a very strategic reason, and they simply don't want to the world to know, and by the world, I especially mean their competitors, before they're ready, right, to unleash that, you know, tiger on the world, right? That's one reason. Another reason could be it's not, the domain name doesn't actually fit into their core competency, in their main line of business, and they're buying it as a, you know, a complement, a supplement, a something that they might do down the road, looks good on their balance sheet, but for whatever reason, they might not want the general public to know, they might not want their shareholders to know. There's a ton of reasons why. It could also be an NDA prompted by a seller who feels like, you know what, for whatever reasons, I don't feel comfortable publicizing this price. So it does happen. What I can tell you about chocolate.com, I've got the NDA in front of me, so I can tell you what I can tell you and what I cannot tell you.
It starts with a big C.
I love that he's still taking a bite every time I say it. That's
well, that chocolate bar is big enough.
So true. So I am free to tell you that the sale price was in the mid to low seven figures, and I will be working with the new owners, and both the buyer and the seller want to remain anonymous. But I will be working with them on next steps through my branding and domain agency, Buckley Media. So super excited about that, and we'll see what happens next with Raiden Get Ready, chocolate.com.
So hang on, did you just say you're going to continue working with them? So you're, not just a domain broker, but a branding agency, and you're going to continue working with them through this acquisition process?
We had a meeting last week, and I'm basically consulting with them on next steps, and I'm not free to say anything more other than that. And for those of you listening on podcast, the reason I just laughed is Shane showed back up at his desk with a huge bar of chocolate.
Hershey's Gold, which
peanuts,
you're taking home.
And
you're a little left out, aren't you?
But,
peanuts and pretzels.
But for those listening, my bar is bigger than Shane's bar.
Oh,
yeah, he's right.
Wow.
Hey, I can tell you something that I bought for fun the other day.
Does it involve hamsters?
Sadly, it does not.
Okay. Can it involve hamsters?
He's just not into that. Okay, what did you buy for fun the other day? For yourself? Okay.
Let me find my buzzing phone and make sure it's not going to interrupt us. Okay. So I bought something for fun for myself the other day. And it is thousandcount.com.
Thousandcount.com.
That's a sheet name, Braden. That's a sheet name.
It's a sheet name.
Like what? Like,
thread count.
Thread count on like sheets and pillowcases.
I won't sleep on anything less.
I feel like it might have a bigger meaning than that.
Nah, it's sheets.
Okay.
Well, is it, right? So put on your branding hat. So it could be, yes, it could be luxury linens, right? But what is that?
Look at the word she says. I said sheets. She said luxury linens.
But let's take it a step deeper. Let's unpack. What does thousand count mean, right? It means a luxurious experience. From the moment you slip under those sheets through an amazing night's sleep to when you awake afresh. That speaks to lifestyle, aspiration, experience, luxury from start to finish, right? So now we're starting to talk about something that is actually brandable.
Mm-hmm.
That really speaks to luxury and experience. and a very curated experience.
The big question is this: 1,000, 1,000, or it's thousand count.
Correct. Correct.
Okay. That's a lot of letters.
No.
No, it's not that many.
I can see and I can
send it. What do you think she paid for it?
Braden. You got the bigger bar of chocolate. Go.
I think she paid $164.
I'll say less than that. I'll say $100.
Real question is, does Kate Buckley value thousandcount.com more than Shane Coltra values organibus.com?
Well, actually, I got lucky. It was not registered.
Mm-hmm. Oh, very nice.
Yeah, I was in...
I wonder why.
I was in Palm Springs with Todd, my boyfriend, and you guys know him. So he's an ad agent.
My name.
Kate's name currently on the screen is I Love Todd.
Yeah. And mine's like, screen capture Todd does not snore.
And for those of you who have not met Todd, equally as adorable. They're a good match. Oh my God,
I cannot wait for him to watch this. He loves you guys too. But anyway, you guys know him. He's in branding. He's the CEO of an ad agency. So we're in Palm Springs, and there's a huge line for brunch. So we're just, we do what two normal people do when we're waiting for brunch is we brainstorm about business ideas and branding ideas and domain names because we're really weird like that. Mm-hmm. And
everyone in line do the same thing?
Yeah.
Totally. Oh. And he was like, what if, we had this kind of company and we were consulting on these sort of luxury experiences and blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, oh my gosh, let me see. And so then we started brainstorming on domain names. And then he was like, well, what about Thousand Count? And I was like, oh, I love it. You're a genius. Which of course he loved. And then I went on and registered it and it was fabulous.
Yeah. Wow. Well, I think it's a pretty neat story, especially when you're around someone else who gets domains, marketing and branding too. And you can really get there to that point. I will.
Your spouse has no choice. They're going to hear about your domain names whether they want it or not. You could ask my wife.
For sure.
They, your spouse will hear more about domain name. Any domain investor, you can see a tree and you go, I wonder if that type of tree is taken. Or they can see anything. It doesn't matter. That's our life.
I make Lisa play the domain game all the time.
Should I put that on my dating profile? I'll be like, must understand domains. And like, what is the app that, who has the app where you guess the prices?
Yeah, that's that name bio.
I like long walks on the beach and playing the name bio app.
Namescon needs to have a spouse seminar where our spouses or better others can just talk about us and say, does he make you do or does she make you do this? Yeah.
Oh, God, I love it.
And they just talk the whole time and drink wine. Oh, my gosh. Every time we drink wine, he registers more domain names. Yeah, I'm sure we're all the same. There's no difference. If you're buying them in line, you're doing exactly what we do.
Yep.
That's my 1% or 2%. That's how hamster insurance came about.
Wow. Kate, how often do you sell a name under NDA? You mentioned earlier, I think, Thousand Count is cool, but chocolate is sweeter. You're going to have to bust open a second bar there pretty soon.
It's a big bar.
Seriously, how often do you sell a domain under NDA?
I would, depends on the year, right? Some years it's a little, like a quarter. 25%. Another year, it could be as much as 50%.
Okay.
This year I would say, I actually went into escrow today on a name, but it hasn't funded yet, so I don't want to talk about it.
Talk about it.
But this doesn't show until next Monday. You can roll the dice and see if it funds by then.
No. So this year it's shaping up to be about,
it's only March
3rd. Exactly. Yeah, I'm like, Yeah.
So right now you'd say one third of your transactions in 2019 have been under NDA.
If we count from December 29th onward, it comes closer to two thirds.
That's the Buckley Media fiscal year.
Exactly.
Well, end of year is a popular time for domain acquisitions for companies who've been waiting, wondering, watching their budgets. It's true. Escrow.com, issued this really fascinating report, and they say we in the domain industry close eight-figure domain sales every month consistently, and seven-figure domain sales almost daily. So considering that we don't hear about them pretty much ever, what percentage of domain transactions do you think are under NDA?
Well, you can't really say percentage because you have all these auctions and other things, but
it's a small percentage.
Over 100,000.
What?
Over $100,000, I would say 70% you never will hear about ever.
Yeah. What were you going to say, Braden?
I would say most of the seven and eight figure names, most super high percentage. I mean, it would be a guess, but I would say better than 95%. Just my opinion, because we don't have any stats on it. Maybe
.com. Under NDA.
But those companies, they're not in the domain business, right? So they're buying a thing for their business that's related, but certainly not related to their income. They don't want their shareholders to know. They don't need their customers to know, or their competitors to know. As Kate was saying, I think it's like a thing that it's like this is what we're doing internally, and we don't need everyone to know about it.
Yeah. So I'm looking, and Ron Jackson does such a stellar job on DN Journal with the year-to-date domain sales, and it has listed year-to-date public domain sales. There are 11 seven-figure and one eight-figure. And so, escrow.com alone is saying eight figures every month, which means two eight-figure sales this year have not been reported or probably under NDA. But then seven figures almost daily, I'm thinking we're 77 days into 2019, and there are 11 seven-figure domains publicly available. 1/7, that's a small percent. That's 14% of seven-figure domains or premium domains are actually publicly recorded. That's staggering. Mm-hmm. Do you think that affects comparable sales and how we utilize comparable sales to calculate values?
I think it has an effect if we don't know about those comps. I have never sold a domain under NDA. I mean, total NDA. I have done deals where I can't talk about it for 90 days, that sort of thing, but that's all I'll do. Every time I have a sale and they ask for an NDA, I tell them I won't do it. I strike that clause and send it back, and I'm typically dealing with lawyers on the other side. Mm-hmm. And they say, well, what do you mean? A client wants it under NDA. Well, I'm not doing the deal. And they always back off, always. Because it's like, look, this big company's buying it. They're going to be using it at some point, so we know it's going to be theirs, mm-hmm. right? If you don't want me to talk about the price for 30 days or 60 days or something, that's fine. But this is the business that I'm in, and I need to contribute to this industry by putting the comps out there. And if it's under NDA, then I'm not contributing. And this is what I do. So I'm sorry if you have a problem with it, but
can you sell a home under NDA? I mean, how you have to report a home sale. Can you hide the price of a home sale?
I don't think so, but I hear what you're saying, Braden, but I don't agree with that at all for the industry today and for getting deals done, because so many companies who are really, building the industry as a whole by acquiring domains and building on them, they wouldn't do it without.
You're not going to make it in this industry, Braden, with that approach. I'm just telling you right now.
Yeah, right. Braden's really.
I should give up. I should give up now. Listen, I have. I tell you, I've never lost a deal because I refused an NDA. Not one.
What do you think, Kate?
I want to compliment you, Braden, on your approach. I wish more people took that approach. I think it's awesome. You know, Michael Costello has that exact same policy. And he'll say, fine, I won't release it for a period of days or months. Mm-hmm. But, you know, eventually I'm going to insist on publishing this. And because it's good, transparency is good for our industry. I can't say it enough. So I certainly encourage that to happen in the negotiation process. I'm not always successful. Sometimes I am. Sometimes I'm able to get it lifted after the fact, right? Like LagunaBeach.com, which I sold for David and Michael Costello, was under NDA for the first year. And then I successfully negotiated with the acquiring entity to lift it. And we were able to release that sales price, which was $600,000, which is a great comp for a small geodomain.
Great.
It is. Yeah, it's excellent. Good for you.
Yeah, it's like supporting the ICA. You know, we need to give back to this industry.
Yeah.
You know, we make a good living here and we need to support it. And so I contribute to the ICA just like I, in my negotiations, I say there's not going to be an NDA or a permanent NDA because I feel this is the way I give back. I'm contributing. Now, just between us chickens, if it was a big deal and they said, forget it, I might cave, right? I don't know. It depends on the situation. You know, am I going to walk away from a multi-million dollar deal because I'm stubborn? No, I'll probably take the deal. But thus far, I have been successful in getting rid of NDAs. So I'll
very, very interesting conversation. Yeah, something I really hadn't thought of in much depth. It's great to hear different viewpoints. Sherpas, thank you so much. Let's take a break. I'm going to tell you about our sponsors for today's show who support us in our mission to educate people in the domain name industry.
First, serious about online trading? Secure your funds, keep your merchandise safe, and use a company that keeps the buyer and seller protected the whole way through. That's escrow.com. Payments you can trust.
All right, in the domain portfolio review, we take user-submitted domain name portfolios and provide honest and constructive feedback to the owners so they can cut their losses, continue to hold them long-term, or figure out a sales strategy moving forward. Today is very unusual. We have two domains. We usually have a lot more, but these two domains, Camden Nettestad had some questions about and would really value your input. Let's talk about them. His two names are Brekin.com, Brekin.com. I asked him if, you know, if there was any backstory or information, cause that kind of sounds like it means something or, and he said, no, he just liked it and he bought it. And then smarthomesecurity.com, which of course, you know, both smart home stuff and security, smart security are you know, big deals right now. He turned down a 10K offer a few months ago, and he'd really like your input on not only on the domain's general value, but on what you think of turning down that offer and when or how might be a good time to sell. So thank you guys for being willing to do this for Camden. Kate, you are up first.
Hey Camden. So thanks for submitting your domain names. I got good news and bad news. I really like one. I really don't care for the other one. Brekin, you know, obviously it could be spelled a number of different ways, doesn't have a readily accessible meaning. Doesn't really immediately suggest itself as a brandable either. And it also doesn't pass the radio test. And has a meaning that I am not going to read aloud on Urban Dictionary.
Yeah,
I saw that too.
That's the first thing that I saw too.
Right?
Very creative.
Yeah, And in Camden's defense, I don't want anyone to be a hater. I think, I don't know what country Camden lives in, but I don't believe that he's aware that Urban Dictionary has any meaning.
Oh, I'm sure. Yeah. No, I'm sure.
Yeah, and I know he thinks so either.
It is, I believe, also a Gaelic surname. So I'm sure that that is why Camden registered it, not the other reason.
Yeah.
So I do like smart home security. And I think that Camden was smart to turn down the $10,000 offer. Camden, if I were you, I would also hold out for more. And something that you might want to consider is to do a little bit of development of the domain. I can see it as like sort of an independent analysis of, you know, the top 10 best smart home security systems of 2019, right? And then you're building content and hopefully you're gathering some backlinks and you've got links to Amazon and whatnot. And you know, before you know, maybe you've gotten an inbound, you know, offer from one of the big smart home security companies. So I think that's a great domain. There's some really cool, fun things you could do with it. And I would definitely hold out for a higher offer.
Thank you, Kate. In what range would you consider, or would you recommend he consider selling it in today? I mean, I know you haven't researched the industry, you know, extensively or anything, but.
Yeah. I mean, definitely my wheelhouse is the one word. But I will venture a guess if it were mine, or one of my clients, and you know, I definitely like to sell at nice prices. We'll leave it at that. I think it depends on his strategy. If he wants a liquidity event and he wants to put, you know, that money back into building up a portfolio with a longer term view, and he wants this to finance that, so he's playing with house money, you know, maybe take 20, 25, right? Or if he's like, no, darn it, I believe in this. I don't need the money. I really like it. I do believe I can add even more value to the domain using Kate's idea, and you're welcome. And maybe I'll sell in 2 to 5 years. Then, you know, who knows? Maybe 50.
Okay. Yeah,
it's ambitious. Great. It's ambitious, but I like ambition.
Good for you. Yeah. And that's what got you where you are today. And that's generous of you to take the time and the risk of, you know, offering a range, and it's okay that it's a range, and we'll see what he does with it. I think that I will definitely hear back from him in a year to 2 years and see what he wound up doing. So, fabulous advice. Thank you. Shane, what are your thoughts?
Well, first of all, he's going to call you and ask you to broker it. I can tell you right now. that's how the show works. So I do have some advice. The first thing I did is go to and type it into the URL. It doesn't resolve. So
wait, which domain?
Both of them.
Not yet. Neither do.
Neither do. So yeah, how did he get a $10,000 offer? Did they go to Whois? He made it as difficult as possible to get offers.
Right.
He doesn't even have a way that lands. That's from scratch. I mean, we all have a couple names that do that. We buy a new auction, we buy a name and we forget, but that needs to be the exception, not the rule. He gives us two names and neither one of them have a way for us to buy them. So that's the best advice I can give them, is you're giving yourself as least amount of chance to sell these names. I did see the first, let's put it this way, on Brecken, you have a really good chance of getting to the top, because all you have to beat is I read a description. I'm not even sure what it was. I read it three times trying to figure out what that means. I don't even know some of those words. So, but to me, I looked at the positive and thought, this is wide open, that whoever wants to buy that brand can own Google. And so I think that's sometimes good. You don't have to fight a bunch of people. Once you get the brand, it's yours to own. So I think that would be the positive there.
So if you put Brecken.com as a buy it now, what price would you put on it?
That's the perfect name for 1888, 2888. There, make it easy. Make a simple number, round number, whatever he feels comfortable. If it's a hand reg, sell for 1888. After you take your commission, you've done fine. That's a perfect kind of name. I'm a big five-letter guy like that that don't make sense to anybody. But as I said before, it just needs to make sense to one person, and I need to make it easy so they can just go with Kate, stand in line, drink some wine, and press a button and buy a name.
I don't remember wine being part of her story,
That's how Kate. Shane remembers it.
If you say after 7 o'clock, then I'll judge.
I thought it was like brunch or lunch. Oh, I don't know.
It was. I'm afraid there were only oat milk lattes involved.
Okay. Well, that's when you hand rag. You know you're drinking when it gets more than hand rag. When you're like, well, totally. 1888 sounds just fine for Brecken.
So Brecken.com, make it easy to list. You're probably not going to have a lot of buyers, so make it easy and low enough that somebody will just make an instant decision and pass out free alcohol to anyone. Exactly.
And that's all you care about is they bought it, and then you move on to the next name. That's what that level of quality, that's how you move names, that's how you make money. If you're not going to hold out forever for a five-letter, nothing means nothing name. The other one... I mean, I think it's a fine name, but I, as I said before, I think somebody in that industry is probably not going to be named Smart Home Security. It's going to be, it's going to be Pineapple. My house is protected.
Prickly on the outside, sweet on the inside.
Yeah, sweet, exactly.
Want to hire me, Kate?
Like me.
So, I don't know what he paid for it. I think... Yes, if he's willing to sit and wait and make twice as much. To me, that's a $25,000 name if you're going to wait it out. But $10,000 if you've got $1,000 in it, and $10,000 is a good amount of money to take and move into the next name that may be a little easier. So, but I operate different. I mean, Drew and I and Kate and I'm a little different. That's why I'm here, is I tend to move a little bit more, and I don't mind the lower end names. But it is in the goal of getting to the big names, to getting to the chocolates and to the bigger names.
Yeah.
But in order to do it, unless he keeps putting money in, $10,000 would get you into a pretty decent name on the next level. But if it's a good name, it's a future name, it's not going to get less in value. So I agree with Kate that it's worth much more. I don't want to say I disagree with her not taking it. I really think that comes down to where he is financially, what he paid for it. What his ability to take $10,000 and buy a better name. And I think all of us here could get a pretty strong name for $10,000.
Those are really good items to factor in. Now, I don't know, but I'm wondering if in your case, if this were the very best domain that you owned, would you take the $10,000 for it now or try to hold out for the $25,000?
I guess I'd have to see how many more offers come in. You know, if that was the only offer I got in for 18 months, I'd probably take it if I didn't get any other inquiries at all. There's some data that you have to analyze on a name. And you know, we talk about this all the time too. Somebody could hold a name for 4 years and I got one inquiry. And then everybody who's going to buy it from you says, oh, he worked the heck out of that name. But it really comes down to timing. The next person to buy could get that offer in the first 2 months. And it just happened to come at the right time. So, you know, that's a decision he'd have to make. And I don't have enough data to do that. It is worth more. I think if he holds and waits, he will get more. But if he's got $1,000 in it, then $10,000 is not a bad number.
Very nice. Thanks. Yeah. All right, Braden, what you got to add? No pressure, but come up with something original.
Well, I'm going to mostly parrot what Shane and Kate have said. I agree. Well, I don't want to say I agree with Shane. I'd rather say I agree with Kate. Just because. I don't want to align myself with Shane ever, really. So Brecken, you know, I think it's a good brandable. You know, it's a pronounceable, easy to spell, two syllable name. That is kind of an impulse purchase if somebody sees it on Brand Bucket. It's a sweet spot for names like that is the $2,500 to $3,000 range. So I think $2,500 and they'll sell it. Camden is his name, right? So Camden shouldn't I don't think you should hold out for more than that. I think that's a good price, and eventually it'll move. And Shane is right about, like, there's really nothing else called Brecket. So it's a good brand because it's not competing with anything else. Smart home security. Nobody that's got a smart home security system is going to want this three-word name. They're going to want to stick with their brand. There's a company called Sunflower Labs, I think, that has this drone security system that's great. This is a drone, by the way. I don't know if you knew that.
Yeah, everybody knows the international symbol for drone. So you don't have to.
So I see that name as like a review site, a blog, you know, that sort of thing, maybe a marketplace, which is going to kind of lower the value. And the thing is, you can't use it for anything else, right? It's one thing. It's only one thing. It's not even home security, right? It's not smart home products. It's only smart home security, which is good in a growing industry, but it can't be used for anything else. And the number that I had in my head, you guys both said, which is 25,000. I think that's the price of this name. And I think holding out for that is a good idea. I think that's what it's worth. I don't think it's worth much more than that. If he took less, you know, if he wants to turn the name, take that money and put it into a few more names, I mean, that's a worthwhile pursuit, but it's a $25,000 name. So he probably paid much, much less than that. So it's a good buy. I think they're both probably good buys.
Good. All right. Thank you, Braden. Appreciate it. Camden, thank you for submitting your domains here for us. And not only for us, but for all of the Sherpa Network to take a look, think through it, and learn a bit. So I hope the review has been helpful to you. And really, let's keep in touch and hear what you do with this in a year or two. Before we jump into the domains going to auction soon, I'd like to tell you about our sponsors who support us in our educational mission.
FD was built by domain investors to increase your inquiries, sales, and profit. Forget spreadsheets and archived emails. Manage your entire investment portfolio in one place using a secure and completely confidential platform. Learn more at FT.com. That's EFTY, FT.com.
So we'll move on now to the marketplace list. This segment is sponsored by NameJet. We're reviewing 11 domains, 10.com and 1.org, that are heading to auction at NameJet soon. If you like one of the names below, click through, because once they go to auction, not only do you lose your chance to bid on them, you lose your chance to even watch them. And that's really what's so interesting about this, is that you hear these market experts talk about what they think has value, and then you get to see what the general population thinks, and you know, they put their money where their mouth is. So let's start real quick and ask, none of you are representing these domains in any way, right?
Not me.
Nope. All right, thanks. So
I mean, I represent the perfect man, but it's not my name.
Oh. Oh,
yes.
Wow, should have seen that coming.
You put that on the tee for me. Thank you.
But
why do you let him come back on the show all the time?
You know what? I don't know. He's willing to come. I can't even calculate Pacific time to Chicago.
That's why I'm going hard, because I figure this is my last show. I'm being replaced by Kate, so I'm going to go out strong.
If you laugh at his jokes, it only encourages him.
He's just laughing because she gets so blaming him. Kate, I'll send you his visor.
Perfect.
Like, he wears this visor all the time. I don't even know what's on your visor. Like,
it says escrow.com.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, well.
Escrow sent it to me.
Escrow, see? Where's my visor?
Aha.
or maybe they'll just send me a chocolate bar.
That's right. Exactly.
Come on.
They saw my hair. They said visor. They think you need to put on some weight.
Brandon, this would be way funnier if we had like chocolate shots or something, because you'd be pretty tipsy by now. A lot of chocolate you'd be eating. Anyway, so Brandon, you're first. Now that your mouth is full, mm-hmm. What domains do you like on the list? What domains would you recommend a newer investor try to acquire? And if so, at what price, or what should they stay away from?
Okay. you know, HTTM is meh. I don't know what you do with that.
Fourletter.com.
Yeah, I mean,
it has a low value. It's a commodity. I don't know, unless you're going to hold on to it as an acronym, but they're, I don't know, they're tough to sell. I don't like it.
Yep.
SIS.org, there's a lot of, that's an acronym for a lot of different things. particularly like a security, governments have their security agency.
Like CIA?
Yes, but it stands for Security Information Systems or something like that. And it's a .org, so people might think that it's governmental. So if there's an organization that you think you can monetize, if people think you are part of that organization or offering services related to that organization, possibly.
Yeah.
OneBank.com, I think, might infringe. There's Bank One, I think. There's West One. I don't know. There's a bunch of banks that
check trademarks.
Yeah, so I would stay away from that personally. Virtual Casino, I think, is good. Star Guide, I think, is good. Handbags.com is a great name, but I don't think it's on NameJet. I think it's owned by eBags.
Yes, you're correct.
Yeah.
You think that's a typo?
I don't know if it's a typo, but it redirects to eBags.com.
Well, that's awkward.
So I'm skipping that one. Luxury Destination. Yeah, it's okay. It's not fantastic. I mean, it's got some value. The Perfect Man is just Shane's Wikipedia page. It's not, I mean, it's Perfect Man is better, but still, what are you going to do with it? And then you add a the, I don't like it. Pure Coffee is good. There's so many coffee shops and coffee brands, coffee labels. And pure is a good word in front of, you know, some like a food product. So I think that's a good name. Pixology, I don't like because it doesn't pass the radio test. And what is it? Life Courses. You know, that's a thing, like, you know, life coaches. So you could take a course, become a life coach, which is another word for unemployment. So did I say that out loud? So it's got some value, but not a ton. I don't think any of these have a ton of value other than Virtual Casino, I think could be a strong name.
So okay.
I tried this fast.
Okay. So like Pure Coffee, what would you recommend someone bid on that as a max bet?
A few hundred dollars.
Okay.
For me, I'm trying to get a big spread. And I don't work my name. So there could be a coffee shop or coffee brand out there called Pure, or a food brand called Pure that might come out with a coffee line, mm-hmm. In which case they can do some outbound. So that's going to give it some more value. Otherwise, you know, if it's a $3,000 to $5,000 name, you got to spend under $500 for it. And I mean, that's the way I see it. But if you're going to do outbound and you can spend $500 and you're willing to sell for $1,500, then great. That's a decent return too.
Gotcha. Okay. Fair enough. Thanks, Braden. Kate, you're up next. What stands out to you?
Let's see. I actually don't mind ATTM because it is an acronym. I think there's some technical use cases for it. And it is a fourletter.com. So I wouldn't pay a lot for it, but I do think that there are some use cases for it. Let's see. SIS I like for very similar reasons to Braden. It's a great generic. It's also a great acronym. And it also has, again, technical applications, which is fun. I don't love OneBank. I do like Virtual Casino. I like it for online gaming, obviously. I also like it for virtual reality, right? So I think that one's a double header that could be really juicy and interesting for the right development project and branding placement. Star Guide is fun. I don't go to TMZ. I don't buy tabloids, but a lot of people do, right? So that's, again, kind of a juicy name that I think would be pretty easily monetizable for the right end user. Handbags, where do we land on that? Is that actually in the...
I think it's men's handbags. It's on name. Men's handbags are on.
Okay.
Oh, good eye. Okay, so men's, M-E-N-S. Yeah, you found it. Handbags. .com, men's handbags.
Okay, so I'm going to pass on that one.
What do you think for virtual casino? What would you recommend as if somebody said, this is going to be the best domain in my portfolio, this is my big investment, what mm-hmm. would you recommend as a top dollar for that?
I think the upside could be so big. I would say if you could get it for around 25 grand ish, more or less, I think it's solid.
Okay. And you think it'd be a long wait probably, or you think you could, then work with a broker and outbound sell it?
I would develop it, but that's me.
Yeah. That's a ninth generation Kentuckian. all right. Okay. I like it. Thanks. No, those are great insights. Shane, you're up.
I'm kind of agreement. I don't love any of these names. They're all fine. I wouldn't mind any of them being in my, the only one I wouldn't do is One Bank. I think Bank One's got it locked down in those two words in the banking industry. So I wouldn't want to touch that one, but any of the rest of them are good names. Again, I always hate to talk build out because we always talk build out, and there's obviously if you build out a good name, but there are some that are easier to build out than others. And there's a couple here that I think like life courses, there's lots of life coaches and you could build online education. So, but I hate to say that because that never happens. We never build any of them out. We always wait and sell them and talk about it. But I do like the name. I understand where it could be used. I obviously liked handbags. That one stuck out a lot. It's not even real. So that one didn't work out so well. I like virtual casino, but I talk about it on my blog all the time. I just don't like the word virtual in the names. I just feel like it's redundant. But I said that about the word online, and that was completely wrong. People have sold somethingonline.com for tons of money decades later. Even though if it's a .com or if it's a URL, obviously it is online. I thought that was stupid that anybody put that in their name, but it still goes on today that they use the word online at the end. So virtual, I'm not a big fan, but I'm almost positive that I own that name as one of my first names. I'm going to go look back in the history when the show's over. I'm pretty sure
This exact name.
So I got to go look at the Who Is history and see. Back in 99 when I first started it, I'm almost positive that was one of my first 10 names.
No way. Okay, you got to tell me before we air. That's cool.
I'll have to go look and see. I didn't have very many good names, trust me. That hamster insurance still with me.
That's Shane's best name, by the way, hamsterinsurance.com.
Yeah.
You're going to retire.
You need the 401k when you've got a name like
yes,
that.
Yes, exactly right. And I liked attention. I saw attention right off the bat on ATTN. Mm-hmm. I don't know why I'm the only one that sees that, but that's the first thing I saw is, to me, it screamed attention. So I do like it. I'm a little down on fourletter.com. I have really good, great. I mean, I have great four-letter acronym.coms. I just don't get a ton of it.
Wait, so you thought ATTM.com and
I need glasses.
I thought that was screens is glasses. not attention.
Yes. Is that seriously N? Is that
okay, Shane, N? Now you're too old to be on the show.
Oh. Oh. I thought that actually spelled the word attention. No, you're telling me there's only four letters?
Superhero glasses.
You want to borrow my glasses?
Wow. Okay?
There could be a whole show on things that I can't read.
73 is the same age. You see? Cacao content and Shin's age. I told you.
Well, the show is running so long, I'm running out of light.
Yeah, no, that's fair. Even the coloring behind you, Kate, has like gone from day to night.
Yeah, it's
we had so much fun before we started recording.
We've been on this call for 2 hours.
Yeah. Joe Rogan called and he said this is running too long.
Oh.
Truly, thank you, you guys. We're at the end of the show. It did go super long. It is such an honor to have each of you take your time and not only chat with me, but give back to the entire community like this. I know you get nothing out of it except these hilarious belly laughs. Thank you. And thank you to NameJet and each of our sponsors. Real quick, anything you guys want to give a shout out to? I know you're like, yeah, shout out to my dinner. Shane, shout out, anything going on besides aging?
Exactly. I want to thank Camden. You know, for people, that's kind of our role here is send in your list. The Fred Hutchinson Cancer Center gets a great donation. We get some names. So thank you, Camden, and anybody else. That helps our show quite a bit. So I want to definitely point that out. I know that you were going to do it anyway, but I am it's really a good cause comes from this. I know when Michael started originally, I know I took it for granted, but now that I see that I'm doing a little bit more work, I see how important these donations are. So thanks for Camden for doing that. DSAD, we added Mike Sullivan to our group. So if any of you were familiar with Sully's blog, he does great interviews. Great guy. He's a Chicagoland area. He lives really close to where I went to high school. Just a great family man, and I'm really happy to have him on our team at DSAD. There's these belly laughs that we're getting here today. We have all the time with our group of guys. I don't know if we're the most professional group, but we sure have a good time domain investing. So
you're not.
I got one more in there. It's turning into a big group. By the time NamesCon is there, I'm not going to be able to ask him for company badges. I'm going to have to be like GoDaddy and buy 20 of them.
Nice. No. Congrats on bringing him on. That's great news.
Yeah. I really like it. His interviews have already been pretty good. There's not a lot in our industry. We don't do a lot. I know that Domain Name Wire, Andrew always does a great job with stuff like that. But it's nice to see more people in our industry doing it. And I'm glad he's part of our team where it's being done. So
that's cool.
Pretty much what's going on. And it's nursery time. My wife is turning into the nursery widow, as she calls herself, this time of year, where I'm pretty much gone all the time. So she's by herself.
Spring planting. Everything's growing. Everything's blooming. Yeah. Good for you. All right, Kate, how about you?
Well, let's see. We fly up to the Bay Area tomorrow, so I'm a little worried because we're going to be doing a lot of wine tasting in Napa.
A lot of domains registered.
So exactly. Yeah. So 1,000 count was just the beginning. I might have registered 1,000 more by Monday. So.
This is going to be good. I like it.
On another note, I've got some great domains under brokerage right now that I'm super excited about. Innovation.com. I just love.
I'll take it.
Yeah, it's great, right? And then I've got a lot of great ed tech names as well, like graduate.com. I also have the plural. Just some really, really fun brands in the tech space, the ed tech space, healthcare. So, and if anyone is interested, they can simply go to buckleymedia.com and click on premium domains.
Fabulous. Thank you. And congrats again to you, Kate. I hope you're a regular on here. All right, Braden, what's going on?
I was hoping you forgot about him.
Why are you talking right now? She clearly said Braden. She didn't say Braden's friend.
He's too old. He can't hear.
I want to give props to Kate, actually. So, Kate, when did we meet? 10 years ago? 12 years ago?
Longer than that. It's been ages.
It's been a long time. You're probably a teenager.
And you were driving a Faradale or whatever, that electric car that didn't work.
You're talking again. Somebody, Tess, can you mute him?
I have the power to mute.
My time. Damn it. So, a long time ago, you were working for the Costellos, mm-hmm. I believe, at the time.
Yes.
And had been for a long time. Mm-hmm. And you have been selling names all this time, very quietly, because they're all under NDA. Nobody knows about it. But I know that you've been crushing it for a long time. And only recently have you kind of come out and let people know that you're moving these big names. And you have not been getting the credit that you deserve. So I'm here to publicly give you all that credit.
Thank you.
Good on you for selling all those great names, because you do good work.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
My pleasure.
Yeah, you know, the domain industry has a lot of hidden talent, powerhouses, investors who are quiet. It really pays if you want to get something done in the domain industry to talk to an industry insider. Because just like right away, I think two of you were like, we know who owns handbags.com. You know, often you know quite a bit of history, whether it's people or domains themselves. So there's a lot of value in that. On my end, it is spring break. It is beautiful. I'm spending like 2-3 hours outside every day. Just me and my laptop, and I gotta move as the sun moves. But I'm very excited. Media Options has some pretty cool things in the works that we're almost ready to talk about. Until then, that's all I have to say. Shane, I'll let you know if I get a hamster. And that's all for now, folks. I feel like we should end on that. Thank you, each. We'll see y'all next time.
Thank you, Tess.
Bye.
Bye, boys.